Hi, it's Ford again. Episode 10 of our Tsuba project. Today we're going to lay out and cut out the ryo-hitsu, the openings on either side of the central opening for the tang, and work on the cleaning up the rim, the outer rim, polishing that and burnishing that. So that's what we've got on for today. Well, you can see that I've cut out the one on the left. I've done that prior to the filming so that as we film now, I can do this one and then we can go straight to the rim. It was just for a matter of convenience. All right, so I'm going to talk about laying out the other ryo-hitsu now. What I want to say first off though is that because this is a higo tsuba, the design ideas in higo are a little bit different from most other provinces and other schools. One of the most notable is the fact that they often had the same shape on either side, whereas if you cast your mind to most tsuba, these two shapes are very different. The one on the left is sort of a little bean shape, not dissimilar to this, but smaller. And on this side, it's that sort of trefoil shape, what I call the fat sombrero or the flying saucer shape. So that would be for the koga, that's for the kozuka. But the higo tended to have same shapes on either side. There are exceptions, but generally speaking, that's a feature that you associate with the higo school. As we go forward, I just want to make a comment about the sepadai area and the sepa, or the washer, that you see on higo mounted swords. One of the features that you'll see on a classically mounted higo koshirai is that the washer is much bigger than the fushi. So this is one I use as higo. So that I'm going to put in position, and then using a standard corresponding fushi, put that in position. And you can see that there's a distinct step around the fushi. So what that meant was that this crenellated edge, and if you've seen my film on how to file these edges, those little petals really stand out much more around a fushi on a higo mounting. They really made a major feature of it, whereas more traditionally, it would be much closer, like a little hidden feature. Higo tend to make it a little bit more prominent. As a consequence, the sepadai then is much bigger. So I'm using this washer. I'm going to center it and draw around it with a marker pen before I then position the other ryo-hitsu. So I'm going to line it up. Lock it in position, because I've done this before once. So I'm really only concerned about the other side now. So here we have it. And using a rather fetching purple pen, which Anne Wolf of Anvil Studios in San Diego gave me this. It's my special purple pen, purple marker pen. Here we go. So now I probably need to adjust that. No, I think that's okay. Now I can use this as my guide with the other template. Of course, I used it that way, flipping it over now, and I'm centering it on the nakago ana in the center here. And I'm eyeballing it to a certain extent, but I've got to keep it in line. And popping my clamp back on. I'm just going to draw it in to check, as before, if that's adequate. I think that's about right. So what I'm going to do now is I'm going to drill the pilot hole out and then come back and remark it and scribe it. And then we'll get to cutting it out. And just for safety's sake, I'm going to center punch where I want to drill. You don't have to use a center punch. You can just use a little punch and make a little mark if you need. I've drilled the hole. Well, before I go any further, I like to get rid of the burr. It's using a jeweler's three-cornered scraper. All right. Now, we're going to position the template back on there again prior to actually cutting, scribing it with a steel scriber. Because this is critical, of course. Come on. Okay. Clamp it in position. Double check. Okay. And now, using the scriber, that's that. Let's push the tape away. And now we're ready to proceed with cutting it out. A little bit of wax, and off we go. I'm staying just to the inside of the line. Obviously, you saw as close as you dare, depending on where you're at in terms of learning to control your saw. The closer you are to the line, the less filing you have to do later, but you really don't want to accidentally touch the line, because then all that careful template work and scribing lines is for nothing. I've got my light playing from my left, so I can see it, the scribe line, nicely picked up. And I have to keep brushing away the filings. Those of you who are helping by brushing the screen, thank you. It's nice to know you've got my back. Right, so I've just realized that these two openings remind me of Mr. Potato Head from Toy Story, which is not good. The edge of the ryo-hitsu in this case as you can see, follows the edge of the sepadai quite perfectly. Generally speaking, on most koshirai, where the ryo hits, the kozuka hits, or the koga hits, comes round and touches the edge of the sepadai, there's a little dip, a little cut into the sepadai. What this is for is to allow the kozuka handle, the kogai, to slide into the scabbard, because it comes in at an angle. So it actually cuts ever so slightly, it touches the side of the sepa, and then goes into the scabbard. So that's why you'll see a very slight curve there. So when you lay out the ryo hits, the kogai hits, or the kozuka hits on a more conventional tsuba, not a higo tsuba, it's important to remember that you have this little area taken away to accommodate the kogai and the kozuka. That's really very important. It is a mistake to line up the edge of your shape on the outside of the oval, because that would mean that the tool would have to be at too much of an angle, and then it wouldn't have enough material in the scabbard to allow it to sit in the pocket that's carved into the side of the sayo, or the scabbard. So it really does have to be quite shallow, like this, not like that. And as a consequence, you do need to take something away. This is one of those little things that you see on fakes or modern copies that hasn't been taken into account. These openings are too far away, which means that no kozuka or kogai could, in fact, be placed through those openings into a scabbard. What it reveals is that the maker of these things in modern times is unaware of the true function. It's those kind of things that give away fakers. And cutting into the wood of the bench peg so the blade doesn't jump. There we have it. Right, so I've cut out quite close to the line, actually. I'm now going to use a fine file, as I've demonstrated many times, and come in at a very slight angle, a 45 degree angle rather, and just touch, file up and touch that scribed line. I'm using this larger hand file, half round hand file, rather than a smaller needle file. Firstly, because if I were to use a needle file, there's too much risk of developing lots of little ripples. Whereas if I'm using this file, I can use the curves that are inherent in the shape. And if you refer back to the film we did on how to use a half round file, you'll understand hopefully how utilizing the various curvatures across here at an angle and so forth allow me to more accurately get a nice even flow of the lines while still adhering to the actual shape I'm trying to refine on here, the scribed line, that is. As a general principle, I would say that you always use the larger file for the job, and of course where you can use a coarser file, because it will remove material much more quickly. In this case, I've got so little to remove, I'm going to use a very fine number 4 cut to put the little bevel on. I shall probably use a number 2 half round, similar, a number 2 cut to take away the excess, and then finish off again with the fine cut as my final finish. Okay, so I'm just at an angle, coming in very lightly. Let the light play on it. I can see I'm just touching the lightest of touch. And like I said before, it's a bit like using a pencil and just shading the line. I'm literally just taking metal away until I touch the scribed line. It might seem, you know, overly fussy to be concerned about this degree of accuracy, but it's all the same thing. You know, recently you may have seen I had to do a diamond ring that had to have angles and forms and proportions, all just very carefully controlled. And of course, if I can't file as I need to, precisely, none of that is possible. So, I mean, I was speaking to Marcus on Sunday. It's Monday now, bank holiday Monday in England, as we slide one more towards a totalitarian state. Happy days. They're saying, you know, that one of the things I say in class all the time, it's all the same thing. So that every aspect of the work ultimately is premised on the same principles. So there is no part that you need to get over quickly, because every aspect is training. Now, this part's important, this transition. As I said before, the only downside of filing like this is that the burr is rolling over the line, so keep going back and just trying to keep an eye on things. There we go. So because I have developed my sawing technique over the years, I now have very little filing to do. So that's my little bevel filed in there. Can you see that? Well, there's my little bevel filed in. And now I'm going to file using that number two cut and coming in across here. And again, just like with the Nakagawana, I have to keep a very close eye on these planes. I want them to be nice and flat. And if I do that, then the other side, the back side, will be equally well formed. So I'm watching always the marks of the file, not the action. I'm not watching the file. I'm watching the marks that the file is making. That's the important bit. And as I'm filing in here, I'm establishing a little flat plane. Here's my little flat plane here. It's curved this way, but it's flat across here. And I can see my little bevel slowly being worn away. So I'm using just the tip of the file now. I'm going to move around, but I'm not going to go right to the edge. So I'm going to just go around one pass and then go back and do the final finishing pass. Perhaps with a finer file. As I say, this is the number two now. But then again, if you've only got one file, you have to work with what you've got. So this curve, of course, is convex. So I'm going to use the flat of the needle file. Now you've got to be very careful using half round files like this, because the edges are quite sharp and I don't want to dig into these sides, but it's convenient to work this area. So what I do is come to the edge, and I haven't fully refined here yet. So you can see there's still some material to come here. So I'm going to move from there across to get this curve right. Then I'll turn it around and feather it in. So that's how I approach this particular shaping issue.
See, I'm working away from that corner. Now, it's a little difficult, so I'm going to turn it around and come from the other side. So this kind of thing is quite tricky. So you've got a tight corner here, and it's coming out, and then we've got to take a flat and bring it in, all the while staying out of the way of the camera, so you can see what I'm doing. But if you refer to that film where I'm filing up the ginkgo leaf, demonstrating how to use a half-rounded file, hopefully that will make sense in respect to what I'm doing here. Now, the reason I think it's important to get this transition really soon is because these are flat planes sweeping around. The light's got to play on them. And they contrast beautifully with the organic nature of the surface. So it's no good that these planes are all, if they're all wobbly and irregular, the contrast only works if this is immaculately shaped as a foil, if you like, or a mirror reflecting the contrast of the organic surface. I'm just looking straight through to make sure that this plane is nice and flat. I'm just finishing up now. I'm using a number 4 cut. In this instance, as is sometimes seen on antique Tsuba, I'm going to leave a very fine filed finish. You can, of course, finish it with fine emery and polish it. You could use scotch stones. The important thing, though, is that these planes are flat. If you wanted to do something really sculptural and file these edges so they sloped out, that would obviously be your own aesthetic decision. And occasionally you do see more sculptural forms. But generally speaking, these sort of functional openings appear to have been treated very directly, very, I'd say almost mechanically. Of course, it wasn't that mechanical. Back in the day, it was a real display of precision, hand precision. Nowadays, when we see a hole like this, we assume it's just been mechanically punched or so. So it's important to understand that that's part of the aesthetic, I think, that this very clean cut through. Similarly, the filed finish, you know, it could be seen as that honest craftsmanship. You can, as I say, polish it up, and you'll find examples of both approaches in vintage pieces. So that's that. The last thing to do now is to deal with this burr all the way around. There are two different aspects I'm going to consider here. Right, having filed up the opening to the correct profile and finished the inner edges, the last thing to do now is to deal with the burr that's resulted.
I'm going to use a very fine cut escarpment, watchmaker's escarpment file. It's very, very smooth. And I'm just going to take the burr off this outer curve. And you'll notice on the other side, I've taken it off just enough so that it catches the light. And it's noticeably soft. But you're not trying to round it over too much. Just enough to get rid of the burr and then provide a little surface for the light to play on. So, just very carefully coming in at 45 degree angle, and I'm not touching the area where it goes onto the sepa die. Literally just coming around. Just to get rid of the burr and leave a very subtle radius on the corners. As I say, just enough for the light to dance on. And light doesn't need a lot of room. In fact, the smaller the surface for the light to dance on, the more lively it is. I'll just do the other side now. Get the masking tape out of the way. And just very gently come in. Taking the burr away first. Again, don't go into the sepa die. And then just slowly roll it a little bit. I say just enough to let the light play on it. Right, that's that done. Now, the inside edge here, that becomes part of the mechanical setup of the Tsuba. There's no need to round this off. So all I'm doing is the lightest of touch, just like here, just to take the burr off. But there ought to be a difference between this softening and this. You can see that on this side. I have taken the burr away, but much, much less. Literally the lightest of touch, just to get rid of the burr. That's it. This was a polished piece, you could just use a scotch then, of course, but we've got a stony surface here that we want to keep. That's that. That's that. Probably need a little bit more rounding of the outer bits to make a proper contrast. You do this while the light's playing on it, so I can fine tune it, so to speak. And right at the end, I'll run a burnisher over that soft edge, which will help highlight it. So as we come in here, you can just see, hopefully, the difference between that and this edge. And that is that.